If they could have figured that out.
Alrighty. So, anyways, here's what we're gonna do. I'm going to briefly go over the 7-5 comparing and ordering rational numbers. It is in your book on page 196, okay? Now, the reason we're working independently on these last two topic lessons is because you guys have been through everything for this lesson, this chapter, okay? There's not going to be anything new on these next two lessons. However, it is an application of what it is you are supposed to be using and learning, okay? Now, a couple of things to remember, okay? Things to remember and things we have learned, okay? First thing, this process does require you to think and act, okay? This process, what you're going to do in these next two lessons, requires you to think. In other words, those first two stages of the brain. Okay? Those first two stages of the problem-solving process. You look at things, and you make a plan. Okay? And then the other thing is to act. And to act means you're going to have to do some work. Okay? It isn't going to just occur to you. Okay, you're going to have to work. You're going to have to do school, okay? So, most of you are pretty good at school. You know what it means. And so, here are some tips to help you related to comparing rational numbers, okay? And much of this should be familiar. When you compare rational numbers, do the following. Number one, think about the number line, okay? This is really, really important. Think about the number line. What you learned in first grade, kindergarten, second grade, third grade, about the number line still applies. If you go left, you're getting lower in value. If you go right, you're getting greater in value. Okay? So when you start to compare and order rational numbers, just remember, think about the number line, okay? The second thing is to look at the signs, all right? Right away, if you can identify a negative, you know it's to the left of zero. If you can identify a positive, you know it's to the right of zero. You know that anything that has a positive is greater than anything that has a negative. All right, we know that, okay? We've learned that. That's a basic of math, okay? So look at the symbols, okay? Think about the number line, look at the symbols, and say, okay, which one has to be where, okay? The next thing is to look for whole units or whole numbers, okay? Because those right away will tell you that if you have something that is written like this, 1.5 compared to 0.3, right away you know this has a whole unit and it's going to be greater than the 0.3. You know it has to be greater, okay? Unless, of course, it's a negative, okay? But that still helps because now you can say, okay, this has a whole unit, which means it's farther to the left than this negative, so that means this is greater, okay? The next thing you want to remember is this. Convert fractions to decimals, okay? Convert your fractions to decimals. In other words, if you get 3/4, turn it into 75 hundredths. That's easier to identify or find on the number line, okay? That's easier to just work with. Remember, if you have a decimal like 3/8, you take 3 and you divide it by 8 and you'll get your decimal, okay? To help you with that process, use a calculator, okay? We've taught you how to use a calculator. We want you to use a calculator to convert, and that will just make life so much easier for you. Okay? So you can see the steps that we have to help us with rational numbers. How many of you guys think those look pretty familiar at this point? I mean, you're like, oh, why is he going over this again? If you're sitting there right now thinking, Mr. Trillo is going over the same stuff he's gone over repeatedly, that's a good thing. It means you've paid attention. Okay? So anyways, that's what we have right there. We have those. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you what's in the book for topic 7-5. Okay? They're talking about comparing rational numbers. Okay? And they give you some rational numbers to compare. And it says you have used a number line to compare two rational numbers. You can also use a number line to order three or more rational numbers. Okay, so the rational numbers they give you are 2/3, 1/75, and a -75. Now, you don't have to do anything if you take the time to look at those, do you? Because right away, if you say, okay, thinking of the number line, left is less, right is greater, do we have any negative numbers on there? We do, right? Lila? Yeah. This is a negative, isn't it? So we know that it's going to be the what compared to the other two?
The least amount.
Yeah, it's going to be the lowest. So we know right away that that negative is the lowest. We know right off the bat. Okay? Now, if we keep looking, do we have to turn 2/3 into a fraction? No, because we can already compare these two to each other and figure out which is the greatest, can't we? Which one is the greatest and why, Joe?
The 1.75.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a whole unit there, isn't there? So we know right away that that is greater than 2/3. Well, that only leaves 2/3 to go one spot right in there in the center. So you really don't have to do any calculating. You don't have to get your calculator out. You don't have to make any number lines if you just look for the symbols and whole units. Okay? And then, of course, the book shows you that, and they give you the two ways, and they say the one way is to use number sense and a number line to order rational numbers. And that is just looking at them. That's the first two steps of the problem solving, thinking about what it is you're doing. Another way is to write the numbers in a common form to order them. That means you either turn them into a decimal or a fraction. And it's always easier to turn them into a decimal, okay? Now, remember, when you're making decimals and you take 2/3, what do you do to turn that into a decimal? What do you do to turn 2/3 into a decimal?
Would you divide 2 by 3?
Yep. You would set it up like this. 2/3. Now, if you don't have a calculator, you know you're going to have to add a decimal point and annex some zeros, okay? And then you know that 3 can't go into 2, bring up your decimal point. 3 into 20 would go a total of 6 times. 6 times 3 is 18, subtract, and you have 2. Uh-oh, what do we notice happening here? What do we notice? 3 into 20. Whoop. 3 times 6 is 18. Uh-oh, what is going to happen here? What's happening here? Lucas?
You have to annex another 0.
You got to annex another 0. Uh-oh, extend the line. 3 into 20, 6 times, 18. Subtract, you get 2. What's happening? Yeah, it's a repeating, isn't it? We're going to continue to get this 6, 6, 6, 6, 6, 6. So what you're going to do is rewrite that as 0.6 repeating. So you know right away that this is going to repeat, but you can compare it now because you know where it's going to end up on the number line. It's not a whole unit, is it? Here would be a whole unit to there. There would be a whole unit to there. That's not a whole unit, whether it's negative or positive. It's still some. somewhere in between negative 1 and positive 1. But we know it's positive 1. Okay? Alrighty. Are there any questions about this so far? No? Alright, now I want to use the number line. I want to show you this one right off the bat. We have 1 and 3 tenths. We have a negative 3 halves. We have a negative 1.2. And we have a 1 and a half. Now, if we wanted to order those from least to greatest, could we right off the bat know what goes where? Could we figure out what goes where right off the bat? Alexandra?
The 1 and 2 tenths would go for the lowest.
Yeah, 1 and 2 tenths is going to go for the lowest because we know it's past the whole unit of 1. We know that puts it past there. Which one do we know comes next? Which one do we, Alexander?
The 1 and 3 tenths.
The 1 and 3 tenths, this one?
Yeah.
Would that come next? Does it have a negative?
The negative 3 halves.
The negative 3 halves. We don't know where it goes over here, or does it go over there? Now, we have a situation here, okay? Negative 3 halves gives us a whole unit, doesn't it? Okay? So sometimes we have to stop and think, okay, wait a minute, we think negative 1 and 2 tenths should go first, but are we sure about that? So if we think about this, it would be 1 and what as a mixed number? 1 and what? 1 and 1 half, okay? 1 half is equal to what decimal? Point what? Point what? 0.5. So this is one, the negative 1, this is a negative 1.5, isn't it? So do we want to like slow down on it? Do we want to think about this then? Which one is actually greater or lower?
The 1.5 is lower than the 1.2.
This one is actually going to be halfway there, and this one will be over, whoops, this one will come right next to it, okay? So you've got to be careful. Sometimes our number sense, we have to slow it down and say, wait a minute, we've got this 2, and we have 3, and that's going to give us a unit of this, okay? So you've got to be careful when you do that, okay? So in this case, we know that this one and this one for sure are the first two in the order. How about over here? This one and this one. Can we look at those and figure out where they go? Mike? What would you say?
One and one half.
Yeah. 1.3, because this would be equal to 1.5, which is definitely greater than that. So the 1.5 is our greatest. Our 1.3 comes next. And then we know because we converted that the 1.2 is going, negative 1.2 is there, and the negative 3.5 is there. Because when we take this and we divide, we come up with a decimal that puts it back further, okay, to one negative 1.5, okay, which is less, all right? Any questions about that? Okay? Just remember to be careful and to convert. A lot of your number sense will kick in, but when they start doing this fancy stuff like this, giving you a negative improper fraction, that's where it can get dicey. That's where you can get confused easily. Okay? Alrighty, you can put away your notebook.